today as we recognize those of our church family who have gone on to be with the Lord in the past year, we extend a special welcome to those family members who were able to join us today for this service of remembrance. One announcement we have for today, Halloween is not over. Due to weather issues, we had to reschedule our trunk or treat for Monday evening, tomorrow night at 6 p.m. Please come and make this a great post-Halloween activity for our children. Laura, do you have something to add?
If you can try to be here between 5 and 5:30 and get stuff set up. If not, try to be here as soon as you can because the park will start lining up. If you invite us when you're 8 to 15, please let us know. We'll skip the next space so y'all can hang out candy and be close to each other for the social distancing and safety. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. Please remember that the offering plates are at the available at the each doorway.
We're going to continue our service and worship time by singing together For All the Saints, which is number 711 in the hymnals. The words will be up on this screen over here. We have some technical issues, and this one's not working. So those of you over here, if you want to use a hymnal, it's number 711. Let's stand as we sing. Verses 1, 2, 3, 5, and 6.
Was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life of Christine Howard. Kenzie King. Let us pray. O God, your word continues to comfort and challenge us. Your spirit counsels and calls us. On this special day we call All Saints Day, we give thanks to you for those who have gone before us in life and death. Today we remember them in the rising of the sun and in its going down. In the coming of winter and the birth of spring, we remember them. When we are weary and need strength, when we are lost and sick at heart, we remember them. When we are full of joy and wish to share, when we face difficult decisions or reach achievements, we remember them. Thank you for making all of them a part of our lives. Bless their families now. Give them comfort and assurance of your grace
mercy. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Our scripture reading today is the 23rd Psalm, which is so familiar, but it seems so appropriate for today. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May we pray. Father, we thank you for this psalm. We thank you for the memory of the people that we have in our lives that are so special to us. Each one of these that we recognize today have meant so much to this church and to us personally. And we thank you so much for their lives and for their influence. May we continue to remember the witness that they had, and that may we be the hands and feet of Jesus for you. In Christ's name, amen.
This time we'll continue our worship by singing together Faith of Our Fathers. Number 710 is the hymn number. And again, words will be up on the screen here. Number 710, Faith of Our Fathers. You may remain seated.
Please allow me a personal word. If you have not voted, I hope you will vote Tuesday. You may have to stand in line. You may have to wait a while. But not every nation in this world affords us the wonderful opportunity we have of voting. John Wesley, the leader of the Methodist movement, had two things to say about voting. He said, choose the person most worthy. And secondly, he said, do not speak disparagingly to a person who may have voted for someone else. Thank you for letting me share. The scripture this morning is from the book of Hebrews. I'm reading two verses from chapter 12 in Hebrews. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And let us pray. O God, may the words of our mouths, may the thoughts and meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. COVID-19 has affected everything in our environment, including sports. I remember looking in the baseball season and seeing the empty stands. Atlanta tried to put up some cardboard pictures of people there. And I wish they had just moved them around every once in a while to make sure that we were looking at different cardboard. Football has been a little different. A few people have been allowed into the stands. Not many, but a few. A few thousand. When the game was over that Florida played against Texas A&M, the coach at Florida made a complaint in saying that the crowd, which was larger than most stadiums, that the crowd had made a difference in Texas A&M winning the game. And he wanted the stadium at Florida opened, wide open for every game at home. Well, that didn't happen. But sometimes we have talked about the crowd in the stands being the 13th player. It makes a difference when there are people cheering us on and helping us and encouraging us. And I've been a part of that a few times, and some of you have as well. This passage is an interesting passage because the passage is put in the context of an arena, a sports arena, probably a relay race. Writer of this passage said, now we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. Let us run with perseverance the race that is before us. What an awesome view and picture of who we are and what we're doing on All Saints Day. Remembering that those who have gone before us in life and in death are now cheering us on. It's our time to run the race. Can you see them up there? Can you see them? There they are applauding. There they are encouraging. There they are sending us messages over and over and over again for us to move on and run the race. On this day, we remember them and give thanks to God that they have been a part of our lives. We have called their names, their family members, their friends. There are people who have been in our circle of communication for a long time. There are people who are important to us in understanding of what happened in chapter 11. That's a powerful, powerful chapter. Chapter 11 is what I call the by faith chapter. Because 16 different names who lived in the Old Testament generation are called out, and it's like this, by faith so-and-so, by faith so-and-so. It's by faith Abraham followed a voice. It's by faith Sarah, who at 90 years of age produced a child. It is by faith that Moses, it is by faith, on and on and on. 16 different names are called out, and then he just simply says, there are too many for me to write down. It would take too long. These are people who live their lives by faith. And we might add a few names to that today, by faith. By faith, people that have lived before us, we know and experience in our lives today. It's important for us to give thanks to God for these who have stood beside us and blessed us and are now cheering us on. You can think of people in your own life. I think of youth leaders. I think of a Sunday school teacher. I think of a pastor. I think of a school teacher or two in my life. I think of family members. You can have your own view of that circle of people who by faith have lived out their lives and are now in the grandstands giving us encouragement for today. The message in these two verses is that we are to continue the race. We are to continue the race. It's our time. We're knowing they're in the grandstands applauding for us and carrying on and cheering us on. The Living Bible puts it this way. The Living Bible says, strip off everything that slows you down and run with perseverance the race that is before you. It's been a few years back when there was a great deal of information shared in the Olympics about the new material for the swimsuits. I don't know if you remember that or not, but they were making a great deal about it, because it was a material that would reduce the friction as they moved in the water. I've done a little running and more jogging, and now I just walk. And I don't worry about getting dressed to resist the wind today. But those who take running seriously will be careful not only about their shoes and what they're wearing, but about their socks. They don't wear any socks up above the line of the shoe. They don't want anything to resist the wind and resist their movement. Take off everything, strip it away, and run with perseverance the race that is before you. Run perseverance, the race that is before you. It's natural for us to have times of grief when we have a loss, any loss. Any loss causes us to remember seriously those who have gone before us and to deal with our own relationship with them or what we wish we had. Ross, some years ago, wrote a little book about grief and described the symptoms of grief. The symptoms of grief, she said, included shock. If it's a sudden death or if it's a diagnosis of a terminal illness, it's always shock. And then there's the experience of denial. This is just not happening to us. It can't happen to us. Or we may get into a bargaining state. if you will just allow this to happen, I'll do this. I'll change my ways. And sometimes we get into depression, and often this is expressed in anger. But somewhere along the way, we find our way to reconnect to life, and we continue to run the race. It was just a couple of weeks ago, I was in the automobile and I'm listening to the radio, and a chaplain of a large hospital in another state was being interviewed. And she was talking about grief, and she gave a definition of grief I'd never heard, but I want you to hear it. She said, grief is love meeting its greatest obstacle. I want to say it again. I want you to take this home with you. Grief is love meeting its greatest obstacle. Wow, I like it. It's natural for us to grieve. We need to grieve. It helps us lay aside those things which hold us back sometimes. It's a stripping off of those things that are holding us. So what does the grandstand say to us today? Those people who have gone before us, what are they saying to us today? I don't know what they would say, but in my imagination, I think they might say to us, what's here is greater than you could ever imagine. What's here? The relationships, the experiences we have in this new life, this new body, is more than we could ever imagine. They might say to us, continue to follow Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and the life. We know that in his death and resurrection, we are not alone. I want to reinforce this message of the grandstands by turning to the Gospel of Matthew. You'll hear it again in Lent, but I want you to look at that one passage of scripture in Matthew's Gospel 17, where Jesus takes three of his disciples, Peter, James, and John, up a high mountain. This is probably just a few days, maybe a few weeks at most, before his arrest, his trials, his crucifixion. And they get on a mountain, and when they get there, they are surrounded by a great cloud. And there are two people that Peter, James, and John have never seen because they come from several generations earlier. Their names are Moses and Elijah. In this cloud, the grandstands. There's no record of the conversation that did take place between Jesus, Moses, and Elijah. We don't know what they said. But when that conversation is over, the voice of the Lord God speaks and says, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." The message from the grandstand. What a powerful message. The interesting thing there is to me, not only the message, but the very fact that Peter, James, and John recognized who they were and had never seen them. Think about it. People who have blessed your life and touched you and want to continue to bless you and touch you now. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to observe together communion. You do not have to be a member of this congregation to receive this holy sacrament. After a bit, when we have had our prayers, you will be served where you are in the pew. Thank you. blessings upon each other. May you go in peace. May you go in hope. May you go running the race that is before you and before all of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace.